Barbershop Podcast from the Rat Rod Rocket Ship. That is BOXO Studio in the shadow of the mountain. Hamilton, Ontario. Greatest rock and roll city in the face of the earth. And we've got a big slab of it every Wednesday night here. Live Barbershop Podcast on Twitch TV. Locate us at will on the interweb. BarbershopPodcast.com. Find us on Facebook. Like us on Twitter at Podcast Barber. Or as they say, just Google that shit. You will find us. Barbershop Podcast.
Oh, very there best I am.
In Hamilton music and musicians. And after a holiday season.
And what a holiday season it was.
There was a lot of seasoning that went on, wasn't there, Ryan Cannon? I'm
still getting over the three holes of Christmas.
That was a New Year's.
Yeah.
That was
last week.
Last week with the New Year's show with Lo-Fi. It took us a week to recover for it. And we're starting with a brand new year, 2015. I'm really impressed with this year so far, Ryan.
So far, so good.
So far, so good.
I have a feeling this is going to be our best show of the year.
Of 2015, I have no doubt about that.
Yeah.
We picked a goodie, though, didn't we?
We sure did.
Okay, I got to say hi to Gary Greenland. We still hasn't got the mic yet because we figured out his Garyversary was in May.
That's when we'll give him a mic.
We'll give him a mic in May, year, because that's kind of where we set the watermark around here at Barbershop Podcast. We go through interns and we got a couple good ones now, though. Got some grit about them. We're about grit here at Barbershop Podcast. And what we have this week is another great addition to the Hamilton music community. Someone who's been involved in it for quite some time at a few different levels. He's a singer, a songwriter, and recently an artist, self-discovered. Got a knack for that, too. He's a great songwriter and a good friend. I want to welcome Dave Pomfret into the studio tonight. How you doing, Dave?
Not bad at all. How are you?
I'm doing good. I'm glad you could make it. It's the coldest day of the year. And I know it's only a week into the year.
It's the coldest day of the year by the end of the year. But this is a very cold day.
It's a very cold day. We've been doing pretty good, you know. As opposed to last year, it was awful for a long time last year. If you go back into our Barbershop Podcast episodes, I think we whined about it.
Yes.
Pretty well every week. But now we're whining this week because we wanted to have another little break. Everyone's back at work and school and they're digging the snow pants out and not digging it. But you know what's good for the soul, Dave? I think you do know what's good for the soul.
I know
you?
What's good for the soul.
I know you do. It's music. And we ladle it out here. And if you come back and you ask for more, we give you more on a regular basis. Tell me about your history. We know a bunch of people. I know what part of town you kind of grew up in. There was a bunch of musical individuals and quite an early thriving music scene in the high school days. So you went to Salfley, did you?
I went to Salfley High School in Stoney Creek. And there was a lot going on musically. I started a band called the Monday Nuns with Gene Champagne in grade 10. A couple years later, Mike Treblecock and Eric E. Raid joined the Monday Nuns, and after a number of years I left the Monday Nuns. I eventually became the Killjoys. They did okay.
They did okay.
Yeah, they did just fine.
They did okay.
There's lots of other musicians in that school at the time. Terry Crawford.
Yeah, love
Sheldon
Terry.
Conrad.
Yeah, love Sheldon.
Yeah.
Yeah. And those are some of the guys when I first came here that introduced me to, you know, the kind of rich talent that there was here in Hamilton. Very technically progressive at a fairly early age and right into songwriting and good music. A lot of times you're only exposed to what's on the radio, your Q107s and your Chum FMs. And all of a sudden when you get people with established music careers, even at that early age, or a really decent record collection, you start pulling some stuff out. What were your early influences? What was the kind of music that grabbed you by the yin yang?
AC/DC.
Yeah.
Huge. Still. I'm still very much a huge fan of AC/DC, but I was listening to metal, you know, Iron Maiden, Judas Priest, Ozzy, Black Sabbath, AC/DC. Exclusively, pretty much that stuff. But when when Gene and I got together, we started playing. He was into punk, like Teenage Head, Forgotten Rebels, Ramones, a little bit of Sex Pistols, and that was easier to play probably than the stuff I was listening to. So we started writing, just playing that kind of stuff, punky stuff, and writing. We were writing 5-6 songs a week, all through high school. And just the cool part about cool thing about punk music is that it's really easy to understand how the songs are constructed. Simple chord patterns and good melodies on top of simple chord patterns. Yeah. And I think everybody should, before they write a single song, they should listen to punk for a straight year.
And I can totally see why a lot of people call The Who the original punk band, because so many great writers that I look up to say Pete Townsend was the first guy where I realized that I can write a song, that you don't have to go to music school and know theory and all this stuff, that I can write a song. And it can be, like you said, it could be three chords, but it's how it's put together and the melody that melody goes over huge. Top of it. Melody is huge, and I think that's a big part of the THB tradition here. It has to be a bum wiggling kind of rhythm, but the melody carries the day.
Yep.
Been some good ones written. So you've been a prolific writer. Do you still find yourself streaky when you're writing, or is it?
I don't ever force myself to write anything. I wait for it to come. Lately, more have been coming, and that's pretty cool. But if I write 3 or 4 a year, I'm happy. If I write 15 a year, I'm happy too. As long as they're good. I like to love my children.
Yes, and if you find you've got something on it, you write exclusively on the acoustic guitar, pretty much.
Almost exclusively. Yeah, I'll get the odd riff or idea on the electric, but I hardly ever pick it up, to be honest with you. So mostly it's this beast right here.
Right. So you came in earlier last year with Fry Truck, a great band. If you get an opportunity, check out that episode with Fry Truck. But you've been playing quite a bit recently on your own, doing solo, as everyone does. It's kind of understood that nobody is married anymore. You can't afford to be married. You have open relationships where you do what you can with who you can and love the one you're with and keep working on your own material. And if you have a good group of supportive friends, they tend to come together.
That's seems to be the way it is. And it's weird because as a kid, your band was your band, and that's the way it was. But it's not that way anymore. Everybody does play with everybody, and it's hard to blame them. You take the gigs that are out there and play with your friends. Everybody's friends around this part of the world anyway, so all good by me.
It's hard not to be in this community because it dwindles, but somehow it goes stronger. I think when you're making a jam or you're doing any kind of concentrate, you're going to, and we're at the point where we've got some fantastic music on a regular basis. I feel bad when I can't get out a lot of times because it's night after night. Great music in Hamilton. If you get an opportunity to see live music, get yourself down. Check it out. Check out the listings. Look at View Magazine online. There's many online listings for live music in Hamilton. HamiltonNights.ca. That's another great new website that's up. And that's the sort of thing that we need to do is to continue to share that. If if you have a show in a showcase, you share it. And we help each other, brothers and sisters alike, here in this great city of Hamilton, Ontario. Well, and enough chit-chat off the bat. We love to have live music, live original music. There's so many different styles and genres that have come through the door here at BOXO Studio in the last couple of years. You said you began with a certain type of music, and it's as we age and become refined in certain elements, the music changes a little bit. Is there a common thread between the music that you liked in AC/DC and the kind of music that you're still playing today?
I think so. Absolutely. At some point, somebody introduced me to seventh chords, and I've fallen in love with them. I use seventh chords a lot, and there's not many of those in punk. Or in AC/DC songs, for that matter. But other than that, they're still very simple chord patterns and strong melodies and clever lyrics. That's what I shoot for, And
that's a good formula in my books.
Yeah.
Why don't you bless us with one of your live numbers? We'll start off with that. We'd like to get as much music as we can. A little less filler, a little more killer. Dave Pomfret right here, Barbershop Podcast.
Cool. The magic in
And I wish you could just sing one with me. With your sweet harmony, you will never know how much it would mean to me. But she can't smile
That's Dave Pomfret with She Can't Smile Anymore. Very beautiful song, a very heavy song. And I know you've written that about your mother, who you've had to watch slowly slip away from you. Sharing pain through music, persevering, surviving, finding strength in music. Is that still a big reason why you write? The cathartic nature of having to say and feel?
I think so. Yeah, I think... there's a lot of that kind of stuff floating around and in me, and it's got to come out some way, and it comes out in music more often than not.
Yeah, right. And I think there's a lot of people who, unfortunately, haven't had the opportunity to explore the arts, you know, on any level. Some people do it with exercise, and some people, there's many different ways, but for many people, art and being able to write and get it out is the first step or the most important step. And you've written some crushingly beautiful songs and some ones that clearly autobiographical from the heart. And did you find when you were younger you wrote from a safe position, and now you've kind of come through a degree of enlightenment where you can write like that, or has that always been your nature?
I don't know if it's always been my nature. I think I grew into it through experience, right? You know, when Gene and I were writing songs in high school, they were fantasy more than anything else, you know. But then it got to the point where it seemed so much was happening in my life that that's what I was writing about. And I almost exclusively write about stuff that I go through now, or stuff that I see people that are close to me go through.
Yeah. And as far as like carrying it forward and having these songs, do you find that the vehicle, be that if you're in a band or if you're by yourself or if you're in a recording process or not, does that influence what you write, or just you're just the vessel?
I'm just a vessel. Yeah. What I write is what I write, and I try to force it down whatever vehicle I've got. You know, like a fry truck.
Creative.
Everything I was writing, I was introducing the band as a potential fry truck song.
Yeah.
And I think I was unique in that way because Dan writes so much all the time, and mm-hmm. and it's all over the place stylistically. So he was writing Dan stuff and Fry Truck stuff, and I was just writing stuff that's all going to be Fry Truck stuff, right? So no matter what, I'm still writing the same songs I would have written if we were playing more together at this point. And same with, you know, if the Monday Nuns were still in existence, they'd be playing the songs that I'm writing now. I write what I write. So,
well, I'm certainly hoping that you continue to write. You write so very well and play so well. You've always been a disciplined guitar player, or you find yourself go through lazy periods, or you can't afford to?
I would say that I'm a barely passable guitar player. That's why I hire people to do it for me. Now, I was actually, as a kid, becoming a pretty decent guitar player, but as soon as Mike joined the Monday Nuns, he took all over the all the lead stuff, and I almost exclusively became a rhythm player. And I still more or less only play rhythm guitar, and I try to expand my knowledge of the neck a little bit, but I still go back to my, my old tricks.
Right in the wheelhouse where you like it.
Yeah, exactly.
I think that's where, you know, as a writer, when you play with other people and they throw you licks here and there, that's great. But, you know, putting together something that, again, sparse finger picking, but you can hear orchestration. You know, you've got I think you've always had that ability. Want to hear something off of your last CD. It was a great CD called No Rush. How many years? About 4 years ago?
Five years ago
yeah. Now. You put that out. There's another one that you've been obviously compiling some stuff you're going to be recording in the future. Tell me about your last CD. Were you, you're happy with it?
Yeah, it's a good record.
It's a good record.
It's my only CD. And I had basically, after the Monday Nuns, I'd been out of the music scene for 20 years. Without a word of exaggeration, 20 years. I was still writing songs, but I didn't gig. I had one gig in 20 years. And when my stepmother passed away, she left me a little bit of money, and I decided to make a record with some of that money. And so it was more or less a greatest hits package, because some of those songs were nearly 20 years old at the time.
But it had never been recorded.
Had never been recorded. So I basically sat down with Mike Treblecock, and we decided which ones to record. And we picked 13 of what we thought were the best ones, and made it work, and had a lot of fun doing it.
Yeah, and it certainly is nice having something forever, because there's a feeling of permanence to
totally.
It.
Totally, and I was perfectly okay if that was going to be my only record ever. Mm-hmm. I don't think it will be at this point, but I was satisfied with the way we did it and the way we approached it. We went all out, really. So
good. Tell me about the first one we're going to hear.
We're going to hear Don't Go It Alone, are we not?
Yeah. So tell me about that song. How old is that, an old one?
It's not terribly old. No, mm-hmm. It's maybe 6 years old, but it's a really, it's a, just a good catchy melody and a good pop song.
Well, here we go. You can buy the CD. We're going to tell you where. It's going to have a link on our website, as we always do, to Dave Pomfret's music, where you can get it. He'll probably deliver it to your house if he's like me in this business.
There are only about eight left.
Eight left? They're collector's items, truly. Yeah. All right. Don't Go It Alone from No Rush, Dave Pomfret, Barbershop Podcast.
I
Pomfret from his CD No Rush, Don't Go It Alone. Great song, great CD. Great city, Hamilton, Ontario. Great bunch of sponsors. I'm going to give a shout out to them. I'm going to start out with the great folks at Shenanigans. You want to get into some shenanigans? Well, as long as it's good fun, you're going to love Shenanigans right across from Delta High School. They're 1305 Main Street East, corner of Houghton. Hamilton, the 289-396-3954. That's Shenanigans. Like them on Facebook. Browse their menu. They have a fantastic menu. You're talking your traditional pub fare, your ribs, your wings and pizzas. Fantastic pizzas. We forgot to get our pizzas. You know, they sponsor us. They usually throw us a couple pizzas. Here we're all starving and we totally forgot. We'll come down and see them afterwards. Can't miss it. They've got, pints on for $3.75, you know, for those of you who still enjoy a pint after work and whatnot, go see them. Going to mention a couple of their specials. Monday, pulled pork, $9. Thursday night, they got the full rack of ribs. You go in there Friday or Saturday, they got, you know, disc jockey. It's not a music club. We got our friends and the people who do that. But it's a good time. If you like to dance, go see them. Friday, Saturday night, Shenanigans at 1305 Main Street East in Hamilton. That's between Kenilworth and Ottawa. Dave, you've brought your trusty red Telecaster with you.
I did.
And you're like, gee, Kev, should I just go all, you know, acoustic? Or, you know, I'm thinking maybe I'd like to bring my electric. And I think you should bring your electric. And you're saying, I'm thinking I've got a new song I'm thinking of maybe playing. And I'm thinking you should play the new song on the electric. And you're like, all right, Kev, I'm going to do that. So you got a little story with this song yet, or are we going to just serve it up?
Actually, no, I'll tell a little story. This is the magic of cell phones. I have on my phone, I record. If I get an idea, I record, even if it's just a little guitar part. And every once in a while, I'll go back through those to see if there's anything worthwhile. And I had recorded 10 seconds of this riff. And I'm listening through all these things again. And I thought, wow, that one really stands out. And it took me a whole day to figure out how the hell I was playing it in the first place. And once I did, I thought it had been a while. It had been a very long time since I'd written just it's not even stream of consciousness, just a pick fun rhymey words and throw them in a song.
Like the Guess Who did for how many songs?
Yeah. Well, I did it for, that's what Gene and I did when we write songs, you know, like it was mostly, and there's nothing wrong with songs like that. Yeah. And so this is kind of tip of the hat to my dad. The first line is, will be familiar to anybody who ever knew my dad. Change a woman's name is the first line. And he used to, long story, he used to talk carny talk, but everybody who knew Ray knew that line. So, and it's called Pearls, and I'd like to think that it's just a tip of the hat to the old man and pearls of wisdom that he left.
Beautiful, for beautiful thing. Dave Pomfret right here, barbershoppodcast.com.
Stays the same.
Coil's a brand new song from Dave Pomfret, our guest in the studio tonight at Barbershop Podcast. Dave, founding members of the Great Monday Nuns, and now singer-songwriter, member of Fry Truck, and generally fine man about town.
With a cramp in my leg.
With a cramp in your leg. You got through that, though. Maybe that was a little bit of pain and angst that you need.
Exactly. That's all right.
You need somebody stabbing you to get the final ounce of true energy out of a song. There's been a kind of a revitalization that's going on where people seem to be giving a little more homage to music. The art's getting a little more of a attention in this formerly hard scrabble town, or a little, you know, I think it was always artistic, but it was always never celebrated at City Hall, shall we say.
Correct.
Or never recognized. But it seems the powers that be realize that in this post-primary industrial phase, that cities like Cleveland and Pittsburgh, and, you know, even the Minneapolis's and the New York's, and the cities that have musical legacies, it's, again, it's something in Detroit that existed long before somebody decided to help spread that good news. And it's nice to know that the people in charge here in Hamilton put together a music office. They're looking how to support the people who support live music. Although there seems to be more and more places where live music is played, I'm finding that in a lot of places it's still kind of background music. Not as many clubs where people go specifically to see music. So I hark back. I was having a little conversation with Greg Provost the other day, and I told him when I saw the Chesterfield Kings when I came to Hamilton to go to Mohawk in the early 80s. And that was, for me, because we're a bit of oddballs, you know, hung around with my friends and listened to Yardbirds and Cream and Hound Dog Taylor. And, you know, this is the early 80s, right? So it was not a lot of people listening to that stuff. And then when you see a band like that live for the first time, do you have like an early live music experience that was particularly evocative or changing for you?
Well, speaking of the Chesterfield Kings, the Monday Nuns opened for them.
Nice.
That was supposed to be at Teasers, where we had opened for Liars at Teasers already. Shout out to Colin Leversage, who ran that place. Great place and great bands. And the Chesterfield Kings were coming to town, and then Teasers was no more. So they moved the gig to Patsy Brandino's Ringside Banquet Hall.
Nice.
And that's where the Monday Nuns opened for the Chesterfield Kings. And it was awesome.
Fun gig, right?
I remember, I'll never forget, standing outside talking with Glenn Marshall. And he's lecturing me on the bad effects of smoking. I don't smoke anymore, but at the time he's telling me I was going to lose my voice and stuff. But that night, just playing with those guys and seeing what the real deal was, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And by then I was probably 19 in that neighborhood, but it was life changing. I think those two gigs, especially because those two bands were very much the real deal, and they're still, in my estimation,
yeah,
really cool bands. And,
yeah,
and we had the chance to play with them, and that was
that was even cooler, I'd
yeah.
say, because I was 18, right?
It
was
yeah.
like, and that was to go into a bar and see real music that you're not going to hear on the radio in three dimensions. You know, that's why I'm doing this today, I think. You know,
yeah.
It fed something. It's like, I'm telling you, if you're the kind of people who watch this show and you like what you hear down at the studio, you got to come out and support live music. Put bums in seats, and there's going to be more places that play live music. Get some musicians paid around here.
That'd be ideal.
Yeah. Ideal. In the old days, it used to happen. Again, it's one of those strange things where certain prices go skyrocketing and other ones, I distinctly remember, you know, how much you were willing to work for, and then how much you were willing to work for, and then how much you're willing to work for. And then a lot of people just stop working.
Yeah.
Great musicians are just like, I can't justify this, you know. But thank God there's a bunch of us who have to do it or can't do anything else. Yeah, and continue to do it regardless. But keep your pride, do it with abandon and conviction, do it for the right reasons. I want to play something that we have here that nobody's heard outside of this studio. song that you came in to work on a compilation. And when Dwayne was Dwayne Rutter and friends were in a couple weeks ago, we played a song called Glory that he's recorded for the compilation record that we're doing here for to raise awareness, to eliminate stigma about mental health. And I asked people to write songs from the first, second, or third person perspective. And you came in and laid down just very beautiful one, just guitar and vocals, and then you brought Maddie in and it got layered up over a period of time. Ryan and I are going to sit down and mix it, you know, all of them, all 12 songs next week. But we'd like to play it for our audience, give them a little sample as we get some of the guests who have been on this record that's going to be coming out, and give them an idea of just, you know, what we have here. Any recollections of this song? I know once again it's a song that's a poignant song, that's a painful song, that's a real one that comes from you know, a precarious place.
Yeah, this tune, it when you threw the bait out there for this compilation record, I jumped all over it because I had been contemplating putting this song together, knowing that it would be a mountain to climb emotionally for me to put this song together, and your idea was kind of the catalyst, or the fire under my ass anyway, to make it happen. It's a probably the most difficult song I've ever written, and it it's about my daughter's stepsister, and she passed away. She had been depressed and got involved in some drugs, and she passed away. And her dad, who's basically my daughter's stepfather, is just a great guy. And I was trying to put myself in his shoes, and, you know, I did my best to put myself in his shoes and try to say what he might be thinking. And he's a firefighter. He's a guy that saves lives for a living, and his own daughter. And it's just, to me, it's just brutally heart-wrenching, and it's so sad that this kind of thing has to happen in our world, but it does.
Well, it's an incredibly brave thing, you know, to step into the breach and to sing something and to write something like that. And it remains, you know, one of my favorites on 12 fantastic songs that are all, as Glenn Brown said, perhaps the most honest record, you know, that I've ever heard.
I'm really glad you put it together, man. I think it's a very important thing to address, and happy to be a part of it, really.
Well, we're going to hear a lot more about it in the future. Oh, I booked Shelley Marshall today. She's coming up in March, and we're going to have a show.
God bless Shelley Marshall. Yeah. I love Shelley Marshall.
She's a wonderful woman.
Yeah.
All right. So you ready with this one, Ryan Cannon? Ready to let her go? All right. This is a great song by Dave Pomfret, Funeral for a Girl, from the upcoming Shameless Subversion compilation out of BOXO Studio, right here from Barbershop Podcast.
Oh, haven't you heard? Today's the day I take her away. And don't say a word. Well, I know you're sad, but it's not that bad. But who am I to say? Maybe you know better. I should let her cry another day. Just don't hate me for this. Don't hate me for it. And I know that it's not fair, but it's not like I don't care. Nothing's sadder in the world than a funeral for a girl. And you try to do your part with a noose around your heart. You're just trying to spare the world another funeral for. Thing. I can't catch them all, so I'm not gonna fall. And I would give them wings and teach them all to fly, but you and I both know. And who do I pray to when I
Dave Pomfret, Funeral for a Girl, the upcoming Shameless Subversion record out of BOXO Studio. You're going to be hearing a lot of that coming up in the future. Dave Pomfret in the studio tonight, playing some stuff from the past, some stuff from the present. The last song he played in the very much in the present, blessed us with a brand new song. Want to give a shout out to hamiltonartist.ca, a great sponsor of ours, and someone that if you are involved in anything that requires printing on anything, you're going to want to give them a call. They're at 1141 Main Street East at Balmoral in Hamilton, just east of the Delta. They have a physical storefront there that is just beautiful with all kinds of custom apparel, t-shirts, mouse pads, jewelry, engraving, custom automotive decals. They can do banners of any size. If you're in the creative field and you require anything, give them a call. Everyone needs buttons, stickers. You know what it's like in the business. You get your name out there. You want to have someone who gets what you do. They are friends of the artist. HamiltonArtist.ca. 1141 Main East, 289-396-1653. Look for their link on our site. If you need it done, they'll do it upright at hamiltonartists.ca. Now, you touched on some of the stuff that you've been working on or been playing, and you've showcased a few things. We've got something that we've dug out of the files that we're going to play in a bit. But you seem to really enjoy, you know, kind of stepping back and forth between the more poignant acoustic songs and things that rock out a little bit. Maybe there's two sides of...
Well, you know, if I were to list my top five songwriters, AC/DC and Paul Simon would be probably back-to-back at some point in there. And so, I don't know.
I feel the same way. I feel the same way. Every once in a while, I pull out and go, man, I forgot how much, you know, like Ryan and I will just, you know, jam out. And it's like, boy, it's been forever since I've, like, put anything through an amplifier. And it just feels great to do.
It really does. And you forget what it, sometimes it's all about just feeling some joy and letting it come out, right?
Yeah,
and that's you got to do more of that, I think.
Yeah. Well, I'm telling you, I've tasked you to get back to the acoustic because you've got so many great songs, and that's what you've been kind of woodshedding on. People have been seeing you around town the last few months, playing out more and more. You're going to do another one for us. What are you going to play for us?
I'm going to tune it first
because
I think something is sounding a little out because it got to take a rest.
You got to take a rest.
While I was playing the electric, so.
And you understand that it is one of the coldest nights here.
Yes.
In I don't know, someone was saying minus 27. I think that they were talking about some sort of polar vortex wind chill that I wasn't aware of.
It's cold.
It's cold.
Yeah, I rode my bike home from work, and it's cold. I can...
No, we're good.
Okay. You didn't have to stop.
Ryan, you're about as stealthy as I am. 300-pound Irish man. Yeah. Got the illusion. All right. Here's a little more Dave Pomfret, live, interactive, and in person at Barbershop Podcast.
Well, if she were my baby sister, I'd pick flowers for her head. I'd hold her hand if there was darkness, tell the world she's not scared. And when she grows up, I will try to keep it. And if the world should treat her cruel, I'd say, don't cry, sad shoes don't fit you. If I could have her for my lover, take her breakfast to her bed, I would pick 1,000 flowers to lay around her pretty head. And if she can't stay, well, I would not stand in her way. And if the world should treat her cool, I'd say,
Dave Pomfret right here in studio, BOXO Studio, Hamilton, Ontario's very own place. So get your good dose of real, live, original songwriter. You got to love the songwriters. You got to love the artists, but you got to love those who bleed for us. And Dave, as I said before, plays with his heart on his sleeve. And I appreciate that. Thanks. Nothing worse than a couched, cloying, little too cute songwriter. There's too much of that. I've got kids, right?
Very true.
They'll learn in time. The real deal, Dave Pomfret. So proud to have him in studio. Now, you touched on the early days with the Monday Nuns, but you got back together and you did a little hootenanny, didn't you? Not too long ago.
Well, it was June 2012, and Lou Molinaro from the St. Hollywood in January of 2012, I think, posted, "Get your tickets early, Liars, June 2nd. And I'm like, dude, we opened for the Liars in 1988. And we would love to, or I would love to get the band back together to open for the Liars again, if that would work. And it turned out it was the same Liars, it's the same, well, the same guy.
Yeah, they're playing Toronto this week.
Right? Yeah, so amazing. Pretty, yeah. I couldn't believe he was still alive, to be honest with you. Yeah. So we reunited, and Eric, our bass player, had moved back to Europe, so he couldn't be here for that. But we got John Daly to come and play bass for us, and we spent months learning the new songs. And one of the coolest things that's ever happened to me, ever, in my life, well, once we decided we were going to do this show, I posted on Facebook that that we were doing it, and I got a message from a guy who does kind of what you do, I think, in London, named What Wave Dave, who told me he was at the show. It was actually January 1st, 1988, and he has a cassette of it. Sweet. And I'm like, what the hell? From 25 years ago? You're kidding me. So he sent me the cassette of the Monday, and there was a song on there that I'd forgotten I'd even written, completely gone from my head. And it was great. So I remembered after I listened to it a bunch of times, I figured out what the words were, and we did it again. And that was just so cool, because it's a song that was gone from my brain.
You see, Ryan, how cassettes change people's lives and how important cassettes are.
Very important.
You see. We had a studio cleaning, and Ryan's 17 years younger than me, and he just didn't, you know, he's like, why do you have these? It's like, wow.
Well, What Wave Dave had them library cataloged, and he knew exactly where to find it. Made me how cool is that?
That's a little different, too. I was close to calling A&E on you. Yours was getting bad. Nobody needs six traveling Wilbury tapes.
Yeah, there's going to be a run on them sooner or later, you know.
Yes, there is. I agree.
Anyway, we got a nice little slab of video of that show. We're going to play one for you right now. Ryan Cannon has got it all queued up, ready to go, and we're going to show it to you right here at barbershoppodcast.com. The Monday Nuns.
We haven't done this for a long fucking time. Welcome. Woo!
Rusty Nuns! We'll be right back.
little bit of Monday Nuns. That's Monday with a U.
Right, they changed it to, after I quit, the Monday Nuns.
Yeah. They just,
to distance themselves from
Yeah,
you.
Well, maybe worried that you were going to be litigious. No. You and your high-priced New York lawyer are going to come blowing in there. Great piece of Hamilton history there. Nice to see the boys having a great time. This ain't Hollywood, one of the great rock and roll clubs here at 345 James Street North in Hamilton. If you ever come to Hamilton, be sure to check out a show there. There's music usually six or seven nights a week. You know, it's nice to see that. Remember the old days when everyone had that and there was a full calendar? It was Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and you kind of almost knew what was playing where?
Yep.
Oh, I love that. I was young then, too. You could really take a beating.
Yeah, it's different now.
It's different now. It takes a little longer to recover, but it's worth it. I tell you, get it out. Go out as much as you think you'll be tired because you got to stay up a little bit later. The trade off from having your endorphins exploding will more than adequately make up for it.
Agreed.
Live music is good for the soul. We're issuing bumper stickers as we speak. Dave Pomfret in the studio here, Barbershop Podcast. Played a little acoustic, a little electric. He's got one more in him. Probably maybe play one more off of his No Rush CD. But doing such a beautiful job, I've asked him to play one more song live, and he's agreed to do that for us. So whenever you're ready, Dave.
All right. I'm trying to not play the stuff that I played with Fry Truck last time I was here.
Yeah.
And I don't think we did this one. So it's called Sexy Like Heroin.
I'm sexy like heroin. Better than it was before. You won't even have a clue that your world is going straight to hell. I do believe it's just as well. Hey. When I'm sexy like heaven, yeah, I'm sticking needles through my transparent skin now. And I love you, the devil loves you. I'm watching down from high above. Try and even up the score. You don't even have a clue that your world is going straight to hell. I do believe it's just as well. Hey, the messenger came today. He wore a never before seen rage. Hey, the temperature's changed again. I haven't felt this golden day. Sexy like heroin, yeah. I'm sexy like heroin, yeah. I'm sexy like heroin, yeah. Hey, the messenger came today. He wore a never before seen rage. Hey, the temperature's changed again. I haven't felt this cold in days.
Sexy Like Heroin. Beautiful song, as they all are, Dave. Yeah. I love it when you tell the truth. I don't think you could really lie through your teeth, could you?
Not very well.
Not very well.
No.
Don't make a practice of it. Certainly not in your art and in your work. You got a big show coming up, don't you?
I have several.
I have a
great bunch of shows coming up. I'm really excited to... So play with a friend of mine. I worked with her for a while. She's from Brantford. She's in a band called Ruby's Revenge. Beautiful girl named Jenna Leader. And I'm playing with them on Friday at the Eagle's Nest in Brantford. And that's like a world tour for me. I don't venture outside these parts very often. So I'm going to Brantford Friday night. And then Saturday night, very excited to share the stage with our buddy Dwayne Rutter and Danny Medakovich at
Homegrown Hamilton, RPM.
RPM, Rudder Pomfret Medakovich.
Yeah, you're going to want to
be there.
Wayne
Train, the Dave Wave, and the Dan Van.
I love it. It got a little thick there.
It did. It was awful. Yes, it was. But that'll be a great night, I think. And I've got, there's a real special treat for me. The family that I lived next door until I was, from the time I was three until I was eight, the McConnells, they're all coming to the show, including their dad, whom I haven't seen in a long, long time.
Fantastic.
Yeah, I can't wait for that.
You have to be like Cartman with the hippies in there, though. You know, you have to like, say, get away, you hippies. This is like reserved table.
It'll be great. It'll be, I think it's going to be, I think it's going to be jammed, and I think it's going to be great. I can't wait for that show.
No, it's going to be fantastic. Three of the premier singer-songwriters in these parts. Great, great night of entertainment. Saturday night here in Hamilton. You're going to want to be at Hamilton's, Homegrown Hamilton on King William Street, right in the core where it's all good. Let's see. I'm going to play one more off the CD.
You have to talk about your next profile
picture. Oh, yeah, that's right, the next profile picture. Now, you've been, and you showed me this. It's funny because you claim not to have any artistic ability or you're not a schooled artist and you can't draw, I think is what you said.
Right? I've never, when I really worked at it, I could draw something that was passable, maybe.
Yeah.
But then I discovered on my phone about 2 weeks ago that I can draw with my fingertip. You just can't put a brush or a pen in my hand.
You draw with your fingertip, and what you do is you'll from a picture you'll do a very minimalistic rendition of the picture with using no grayscale, just black lines, and you seem to have the ability to capture the innate quality to make a picture recognizable when there's not a lot of material. That's a hard thing to do, and it was recognized, I think, as you said, by a bunch of other people before you kind of went, oh, maybe I do have something going on here. And I've heard this time and time again that people, you know, it's like, oh, geez, I'm still trying to play the goddamn guitar, and now I've found something I really dig, and I'm potting now, or I'm weaving, or something of that light. So you're gonna pursue this now. You think Danny probably set you up with some sweet software, right?
He probably could, although I'm enjoying
you're happy just with doing your phone.
Totally, I did buy some. Oddly enough, this is a weird thing too. My mother-in-law, Tennis's mother, up in Midland, we go there for New Year's. And I don't even know if I had mentioned to her that I'm drawing these things on my phone, but she's an artist. And what she had given me, here's your Christmas present, we hadn't seen her for Christmas, it was a sketchbook. And what the heck, for lyrics, she said. But
It's clearly a sketchbook.
It's a sketchbook. It says sketchbook on the front. So I've got a sketchbook. I went and bought some charcoals. I'm going to see if I can do it with charcoal.
Great
too.
Stuff.
Yeah.
Great stuff. All right, if you had to pick one more tune off of No Rush that people want to hear, something with a little production and orchestration, as you said, you went all out.
Yeah,
and
we did. We went to lots of instruments, and Darcy Heppner on saxophone, and Troy Downing on trumpet. Aaron Goldstein played pedal steel, and Mark McIntyre on bass.
Yeah.
Wow, just a great bunch of musicians. So I think we should play a song that I don't play anymore because I can't hit all the notes no more. But it's called No More Missing You, and it's a great pop song. It's one that came to me in the amount of time it takes to listen to it. It was done. It came to me complete.
You love those ones, don't you?
I love them. I love this song.
Because you know they're winners right off the bat. Yep. If they come, it's like, I'm just the vessel in here. It's flowed through
me.
I don't have any pride or ego in this.
Exactly. I didn't write it, but I take credit for it.
All right. Here's a taste right here, Barbershop Podcast.
Pretend I'm at the circus with you for the rest. more missing you. No more missing you. Smile in her eyes and a moon girl tattoo. We can celebrate the stars in the sky, the sun and the moon. I'm gonna do it with you. Yeah, I'm gonna do it with you. We can wait until we see that the world is stopping.
No more missing you. The art of Dave Pomfret right here at Barbershop Podcast. Another fantastic episode. I think it's number 111, wasn't it, Ryan? 111.
Very nice.
That's
very
pretty nice. That's a nice number. I think that's got some sort of feng shui-ish numerology mojo going for it.
Cool.
111. Good stuff. From all the folks at Barbershop Podcast, we wish you a very happy 2014 gone. 2015, diving in head first. Good things coming each and every week. Next week, we have Mr. Brendan General coming in here. He's got the Perfect Strangers. He's got that whole Lake Erie crowd going to come in and kick some butt. So that's going to be another great show. Just get better and better and better and better and better and more fun and more fun each and every week. Barbershop Podcast. For Gary Greenland, Ryan Cannon, tonight's guest Dave Pomfret, thank you for coming out.
Thanks.
Enjoyed your company.
Don't you act this way.